Hi, I'm Dr. Sridhar Kalyanasundaram, consultant neonatologist. I work at Dubai and I would like to thank the organizing team for giving me this opportunity. I'll be giving you an overview of skincare in newborns and infants. I hope this is helpful. I'll go over the initial slides a bit fast just to keep up with the time. These are all information you probably already know. Skin is the largest organ in the body and very essential to prevent skin-related problems by taking appropriate skincare measures. The role of the skin, multiple roles, I'll just skim through them. It's a protective cover for the inner organs, and having an intact layer prevents infection entering through the skin. It insulates to prevent heat loss, and it also protects against cold, especially if you have a good subcutaneous fat layer. The melanin layer protects against the UV rays, and that's why we have darker skin as we go further down in the hot climates. We have a natural sloughing process, and the acidic pH helps to reduce colonization with pathogens as well. We have the skin as an organ for our tactile sensory input for sensations like touch, pressure, temperature, pain, and itch. And it's also an important role in thermoregulation, where we get overheated. For example, we sweat to cool down, and the cutaneous vasodilatation helps with the heat changes. Of course, the most important part is the cosmetic appearance or well-being, and people do look at your skin as a measure of your well-being. And parents obviously look at their infant skin. They want it to be perfect, and they are worried a lot if there is any issue with the skin. It's also an immune gateway, and it has antigen-presenting Langerhans cells in the deeper layer. We will be discussing the gut microbiome as well as we go on. So this slide gives you some examples of where we can go wrong with infant skin. The stratum corneum is a very important layer, and if the stratum corneum isn't maintained well, we may have problems. So in premature babies, for example, we have very few layers. It's a very thin skin. If you don't maintain your skin well, the lipid layer may be disrupted, the cells are damaged, and when there is damaged cells, the irritants and allergens can enter through the skin as well as pathogens. The same will happen if there is occlusion, where there is disruption of the lipid barrier. So the adult skin is not the same as an infant skin. And obviously, the infant skin is thinner in terms of the stratum corneum, about 30% thinner. So it can absorb or deabsorb at a faster rate. The cells are also smaller, and they produce less of the natural moisturizing factors, and they have fewer lipids as well. Newborns as a whole have a larger surface area for their body weight, and so temperature related changes are much higher, and if the skin is damaged, it has a bigger impact. So what happens due to the underdeveloped stratum corneum? We may have risk of toxicity from topical agents. For example, many of you who work with newborn might have faced a situation with chlorhexidine burns. If there is an exposure for a prolonged period, we may have increased fluid and heat loss, traumatic injury. We will be discussing MARIS, or medical device associated injury, and portal of entry for infection as well. So the stratum corneum is very thin in preterm babies, and the cornification happens over the first 2 weeks. We need to take adequate measures to minimize the transepidermal water loss, and humidification in the plastic bag as we receive the babies, as well as the humidity in incubators, are measures to improve this aspect. The junction of the dermis and epidermis is going to be very important. It has few fibril connections, so medical adhesive related injury to the skin is very common. We call it MARIS in short. So because of these fewer fibril connections, if we peel the tape, it leaves the stratum corneum damaged, and that is a portal of entry of infection as well. So we should be very careful in how we use skin products, and try to minimize the use of sticky tapes and things in the babies. And obviously, appropriate guidelines are important for managing these babies. We will have a few slides on the skin microbiome, which is a very important topic as well. So the skin is one of the parts of the body which are colonized by an extensive array of microorganisms. We know we have the gut microbiome, which is the biggest, 10 to the power of 14 microbes are present. And in the skin, we have 10 to the power of 12, which is the next most important. And oral cavity, vagina, these have their own milieu. The healthy skin microbiome is a diverse ecosystem of microbes. The unhealthy skin microbiome is associated with lesser microbial diversity. You may have more pathogens. The cutaneous innate and adaptive immune response can modulate the skin microbiota, and vice versa as well. So as I mentioned about the Langerhans cells, in addition to that, the type of bacteria that is there, they may induce tolerance, which is the best response to avoid irritation and injury, or they may induce allergy and so on. So what are the factors that can affect our skin colonization or the resident flora? So the same factors which affect our gut microbiome has an impact on your skin microbiome as well. For example, in the mode of delivery, if the baby is delivered by vaginal delivery, there are definite studies which show the vaginal flora take over on the baby's gut microbiome as well as the skin. While if the baby is born by cesarean delivery, the mother's skin as well as the surrounding environment plays a role on what we get colonized with. Antibiotic use in the neonatal period negatively impacts normal colonization of the skin as well. Early skin-to-skin care and breastfeeding are obviously very important aspects to help support this to go in the right track. And use and nature of the skincare products as well as a regular skin routine is important to maintain the skin pH in a suitable way as it impacts on the skin microbiome. So balanced microbiome is important as we discussed, and there are conditions which can happen due to the imbalanced microbiome. The pH balance of around 5 is important as it inhibits the growth of pathogens and supports the growth of the good bacteria, so to speak. The bacterial diversity differs by the body zone. So we have differences in the skin temperature, texture, thickness, humidity, and chemistry in different parts of our body. For example, we may have a different group in the armpit, so we smell more due to that. We may have different germs in the genital area. We may have different germs on the face and so on. So the nature of the skin, the way we treat the skin there also makes an impact. The skin is important to be intact to protect us from external aggressors like allergens, germs, dirt, and ultraviolet light as well. And despite being constantly exposed to large numbers of microorganisms, the skin can discriminate between beneficial and pathogenic organisms. So we have tolerance to the beneficial pathogens. So as I mentioned, acne, rosacea, atopic dermatitis, they all have important response. As for example, in atopic dermatitis, we get colonized with Staphylococcus. We have a Bursal disease, which may have more flare-ups. The diversity and richness of the skin microbiome are reduced, as I said, in patients with atopic dermatitis. And by appropriate skin care, improving this diversity may improve the severity as well. And we discussed the method of birth, the bathing and skin care routines, the maternal microbiome and family and household contacts, their microbiome as well. Environmental factors like temperature and humidity and other factors may affect between balanced microbiome and unbalanced one. So the first exposure is at seeding before the vaginal birth when the rupture of membranes happens. And as we discussed earlier, the difference between vaginal and C-section skin microbiome. The difference related to the baby's birth mode is no longer apparent by 1 month, but it does make a lasting impact, even though this change is in the gut microbiome. For example, changes can persist for 6 to 12 months, and it has been shown to impact long-term health as well. This continues to change and evolve during infancy and early childhood. The skin microbiome is not stable like in adults, and we may need special care to protect the evolving microbiome and development of skin problems to be reduced. And there have been studies which show a good concordance between the mother and infant dyad all through the first year of life. So you can see how much of comparison. I mean, this is a general population. And in that particular mother, whatever bacteria is there, the baby also has a similar proportion. So this concordance is because of the skin-to-skin care, the breastfeeding, a similar environment between them, probably a similar skincare routine as well. And it's very important to have an intact skin surface, and for that we need emollients. And when we have an intact skin surface, we have a good microbial richness. So the richer the microbial nature, the nature of the bacteria are suitable, the less the pathogens get onto the skin, the more the tolerance and the better the skin texture. So the healthy skin has a balanced microbiome with the intact barrier, where an unhealthy skin with the broken barrier may have an abnormal microbiome pattern and a dry, itchy skin as well. When we look at mothers' perception of whether their baby's skin is dry, only 10% feel the baby is dry, while in reality, after they are assessed by experienced dermatologists or pediatricians, 63% qualify as dry. So it goes to show how much we need to educate the parents to how to maintain the skin and to pick up dry skin from normal skin and so on. Education is very important, and infancy is an opportunity to continue to support the microbiome development regardless of the delivery mode. So we can't, the delivery mode is not a baby's fault, and we can't blame the parents for that as well, because the natural situation, the obstetrician will make the decision. But we should try to do the cesarean section only if it is essential. And early and exclusive breastfeeding should be supported as best as we can. Regular skin-to-skin contact should be encouraged, and appropriate nappy and skincare routine should be supported. So when we advise parents about the skincare routines, we can tell them to avoid soaps and adult skin products which may be harsh for the baby's skin. Use mild and gentle formulations which are comparable with the baby's naturally developing skin microbiome, and we should try to support the natural skin pH as well. A mild newborn wash and lotion routine may help to improve the richness and provide the right environment for the microbes to flourish. Multisensory stimulation during bathing should be stressed on as well, as the bath time is a good opportunity for this. What the baby smells, sees, feels and hears during the bath time can be utilized, and pre-bath use of massage oil like mineral oil can be used. Massage has various advantages, and there are definite studies which show enhanced infant circadian rhythm adjustment and better sleep, reduced colic and better weight gain, better self-soothing ability. They interact better and they have reduced stress levels. Probably the parents have reduced stress levels as well if the baby sleeps well. So we have to stress on one aspect of the baby's natural skin moisturizer called the Vernix at birth. So all of you are midwives and nothing, you see this every day. Vernix is nothing but sloughed cells from the stratum corneum and secretions which help establish the skin microbiome. So this is very early. The stickiness may be one reason why the mother's own organisms get on the baby's skin and help to colonize, and the same way in the gut as well. So it protects the baby from injury, infection and transepidermal water loss. It's a natural skin cleanser and moisturizer with anti-infective, antioxidant and even wound healing properties. The WHO recommends that the Vernix should not be removed from the baby's skin for at least 6 hours and should be left to absorb. And we educate the parents. It may look ugly, but tell them it's very useful, very important for the baby, and educate them to keep it on. So use a mild baby oil to preserve the Vernix. Don't bathe the baby for the first 24 hours, both for this reason as well as to maintain the temperature. The baby's skin needs adequate hydration. So as I said earlier, cleansing followed by protection by using an emollient is very important. The emollients moisturize and protect by penetrating the upper layers of the skin without the pore clogging and provide optimal skin barrier protection. It causes a lipid barrier which may prevent the entry of pathogens and allergens. Only the emollients that help to protect the skin barrier should be considered. If you use vegetable oils, for example, because of their oleic acid content, it can damage the skin. Desquamation may happen, so it's not ideal to be used. And very important that we moisturize on wet skin. So educate your families that not to dry the skin fully. The skin moisture is preserved more if you wet the skin and apply the moisturizer on it. So this is an example, an extreme example, a collodion baby. Baby could die if you don't take appropriate care of the skin due to cracking, infection and so on. And you can see with tender care with appropriate products how the skin improves and becomes almost normal with time. This is ichthyosis, where the baby will have a dry skin but doesn't look anywhere as grotesque as this as they grow on. So it's very important to maintain the skin hygiene and health. And most parents, caregivers, they intend to do good and they research products. They know that they need to eliminate some chemicals. They need they are worried about preservatives. So it's our idea to educate them on what is important and what is not. So the products should have the ingredients and elements will help to nurture and maintain the microbiome with no risk of damage. So it's very important that we don't stress on certain components, as long as natural products may also have components we don't know. And most of the products, including companies like Johnson's Baby and other companies, they produce mainly natural products with some additives which are needed to support the condition. And if they have fragrance used in the products, they should be ones which are approved for baby skin, so they will be less likely to be allergenic. So if they have been tested and they are shown to be of low allergenicity, the fragrance does help in the stimulation, for example. Soap is an effective cleanser, but it causes dryness and irritation, and it could be because of removing the surface lipids, and they're also alkaline and affect the acid mantle. So soap should not be used in the first year of life, and you should go for soap-free gentle cleansers. So some key points to stress: water is the basis for cleaning procedures, but water alone is not effective cleansing method. And depending on the pH of the water, the hardness of the water, it can dry or irritate the skin as well. If the cleaning products are used, they should be specially formulated for infant skin, and they should have been clinically tested to ensure they're appropriate as well. Vegetable oils, we will see in the next slide that olive oil can break the skin barrier due to the desquamating ability, so it shouldn't be routinely used. Medicinal grade mineral oil is chemically inert. It has a low allergenic potential and it has been used for many years. It's safe for the baby skin as well. Some preservatives are added to skin products to prevent their contamination by the bacteria and fungi. This should be informed to the parents. Don't be alarmed, because the quantity of these preservatives is going to be low and it's not going to harm the baby's skin. However, having it is important so the product doesn't get degraded or damaged and it doesn't induce harm by itself. So Professor Clark had mentioned in dermatology, olive oil is used to break down scaly skin, as in seborrheic dermatitis. So it does have a role in dermatology, but for the same reason, because it has desquamation properties, it shouldn't be used in healthy babies as it breaks down their skin barrier. And there are reports of sensitization and allergy as well when you use vegetable oils. On the other hand, cottonseed oil contains many positive factors like vitamin E, fatty acids, and antioxidants, which may have benefits for the skin. So moisturizing and anti-inflammatory properties may be attributed to these. Certain fatty acids increase the skin permeability, which helps it to absorb the other products like linolenic acid, which is an essential fatty acid, which is also available in the cottonseed oil. So there are new generation products, including cottonseed oil, which you may consider for your baby's care. So the question that we ask is, baby skincare today based on evidence? There are plenty of studies supported by major researchers. However, not all skincare is based on evidence. There exists an informed uncertainty among the healthcare professionals, and an European Roundtable Conference of Dermatologists recognized the need for an improved evidence base. And the healthcare professionals also get their knowledge from belief system. The mothers may get their knowledge from their families, from their providers, and the healthcare providers can get their knowledge from personal experience as well as guidelines and professional papers. So there is a huge impact if the appropriate knowledge doesn't get disseminated. There is a huge professional debate among the professionals regarding the products. There may be inconsistency in advice we give to parents. So some of the main things we have to stress in newborn skincare is prevention, by regular use of emollients, having the use of simple and mild products that don't harm the skin in the first place, not to overdo things as well. And our role is to support families with the correct advice from the early stages. As I discussed, I mean, as a pediatrician, we see skin-related problems in addition to colic and feeding problems as one of the major concerns that parents have in the first few weeks. And I mean, obviously, if we start talking about it right from birth, if we give them the right advice, as we have discussed earlier, it helps to allay their anxiety and possibly we may prevent some of the problems to a significant extent. So thank you for listening. And I think we'll have a few minutes for questions. You can contact me if you have any questions on my email, which is given here. And I also have a YouTube channel, which has many playlists on newborn care, child care, infant CPR, choking, so you can share it with your families and patients. So you can search on YouTube as Sridhar K. So I thank you for your attention, and if you have any questions, I'd be very happy to address them.